If you're trying a wild experiment of getting people to genuinely connect and survive and go deeper and mirror each other in a safe enough place that they can grow and shine, this is a huge and impossible almost experiment.
This not just a casual event, you know, for people to say, sure, I'll join your tribe. I mean, there's some very deliberate structures that you have built that you mentioned. It's like formalizing friendship, although it feels even fuller than that.
Mm-hmm.
So, talk to us about the model and the stages that you have that you've built in for this.
Okay. Let me start. I have failed at building community for about 40 or 50 years.
Congratulations.
I've wanted it so much all my life. You know, in college, all I cared about was my fraternity. And about every decade, I would gather a bunch of people together and say, people, let's build community. And they all say, Bill, that's a great idea. And it didn't work out. Didn't work out the next decade. Finally got to Ashland. I got together these amazing Ashland people and said, people, let's build community. And they all said, Bill, that's a great idea. And that didn't work out. So I finally got the definition of insanity, which is doing the same thing. What I learned was that getting a group of people together to build community simply doesn't work. And what does work, what we finally succeeded with, is one person. Because community or tribe is me and you, and that's it. And it's you and him, you and her. It's all a bunch of individual relationships. So what actually works is having one person, maybe two people, maybe three, that have some values that they then bring to the next, or a structure that they bring to the next people. And as you know, the values and structures we have are pretty general, pretty generic. Almost anybody can get their arms around them, but they have to be there so that we know basically who we are and what we're doing in common. And once people buy into that, tribe starts.
My understanding from Diana Leaf Christian, who informed who's written and looked at communities all over the world for several decades, most of which fail, is that agreed upon set of values that you as a group have and commit to valuing, those communities that don't have that don't last, because once you reach, you know, differences of opinion or whatever, what are you going to base it on?
Yeah.
Well, that's an important point, because you need to have people on the same page as to what their values are, and she made such a point about this, is that people come together, often in a community where they're living on a shared piece of property. And somebody is passionate about solar technology and new technology. That's what they're passionate about. And another person is there because they are passionate about spiritual connection. And somebody else wants to do processing and emotional connection. And that is not necessarily a mix. They don't have the same value. Our value is intimacy and our tribe and connection.
Our deep value is intimacy, which is a very kind of a subtle thing. And it calls for making a distinction between bridging groups and bonding groups. Okay, this comes from Robert Putnam, who wrote that book 20 years ago called Bowling Alone, a title I just love. And he specifies that bridging groups are groups that get together with the intention, here's their mission, is to reach out and, you know, take care of homeless people or take care of kids or whatever. They're service groups. Bonding groups, it's all about us. It's all about focusing in. And that's what our tribes are. They're all about focusing in. Now, I've watched this with, like I say, thousands of groups in the Mankind Project over 30 years. And those groups are all about focusing in. They're men's support groups. They're all about focusing in. And what happens is the men grow so much that they get to this point where they're fulfilled, overflowing, and at which point there's nothing to do but be of service. So then they become these beautiful men of service. And then they figure out all kinds of bridging ways to be of service to others. So that's something that's happening in our tribe also. So the values that we have reflect us as a bonding group. That's the integrity
which
and
is
trust.
Exclusive. I mean, that's a piece of that, is that it's not, you actually have a process whereby you start with your champions, you say, and then you invite another or another couple who share values, and you actually sponsor them. I mean, there's some way where you build some trustworthiness. Is this person really likely a fit? But you're also, I think, there's a way that that exclusivity, I mean, you end up at whatever size you all feel good with, and it's not open to outsiders.
No. Well, it's a delicate balance because we're asking people, are you willing to come together and be inclusive with all these other people? Include your life on a deeper level and be inclusive.
And that's true.
Yet, there's a place where it's perceived and is exclusive also. There's been so many groups, some of these inventions that Bill came up with, you know, as he was trying to say, people, come together, let's have community. I remember In My Village is one that you created, and it lasted only so long, but there would be some characters that would come to be a part of that, and they just made it unrewarding to come to meetings that eventually people get ground down and nobody comes to meetings anymore.
The really dysfunctional people or
particularly needy people that could be served in maybe some other different way. But if you're trying a wild experiment of getting people to genuinely connect and survive and go deeper and mirror each other in a safe enough place that they can grow and shine, this is a huge and impossible almost experiment. So for optimum conditions, for it to grow, we found that we need to have this structure process.
We have a whole chapter in the book called Do I Have a Right to Choose? Because there's a whole bunch of folks that they must be inclusive, which is the province of churches, but we're not a church. We're a very deliberately chosen group of people that make a commitment to each other for our own growth and intimacy.
Going to those structures, you modeled this after the lodges. Tell us about that.
Formal
process.
Oh, that's a good story. Because I've been in men's work for 30-some years now, I started studying the old fraternal lodges that started like 150 years ago. And what was happening was that the men were coming off the farms and they were going into the factories and the mines, and they'd often get killed. And there was nobody to take care of their kids and their wives and family. So they literally built all of these fraternal groups, like the Elks and the Moose and the Masons and the Odd Fellows and Knights of Pythias. At the turn of the century, half of the American population of men and a lot of women were in a fraternal group. That was their way of taking care of each other. That was the social safety net. That was something that, you know, as we became wealthier and Social Security came in, they no longer had a function. But as you know, Janaea, from doing the work you're doing, we're heading for a time where we are so going to be needing each other again. So being able to see that, this is kind of a preemptive attempt to put together the kind of bonded family tribe. I love the word. We used to use the word community, but it was too big, so we used the word tribe, which actually works better, so that we can care for ourselves looking into the future. I'm also working on a project with my brothers now to build lodges using that very same model, which is everybody that comes in has to be sponsored in. They make certain promises to values and a time and a little money. And again, it's the commitment thing that is so important. In our book, we have not just a chapter, we have a whole section on commitment. Commitment to each other, commitment to time together, commitment to place. And for some reason, our culture is really commitment phobic, and the only way home, it's kind of like a marriage. There's something magic that happens when that commitment is in place, and something magic happens in our tribe when commitment comes in.
You have to be willing with commitment. You know what you're saying is thick or thin, easy or hard.
Yeah,
I will stay with it, and in this culture, it's very easy to just slip out of a marriage, just leave, you know, the mobility that we're allowed. And the models we have don't tend to show healthy, long-term relationships and tools for people. Mm-hmm. Okay, what do you do when the going gets rough?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I see that your tribe in particular, because you value that intimacy, that integrity, that kind of honesty, you've also drawn and sponsored, I would say, brought into your lodge people who by sharing those values have also willing to do that hard work or have already done some of that and can bring it to share.
Mm-hmm.
Not all groups are going to be as skilled. I heard a level of maturity with the people when you describe the people that come in, that you've invited into your tribe. And I see that the process of people applying, they actually do, and being sponsored by another. I mean, you're putting the sponsor on the line also. You're not giving us a flake here, are you?
Exactly.
That you are building some checks and balances or safeguards into that process. Mm-hmm. Jumping ahead to another piece that sounds that may be strong for your group and might not be for every group, is you place a big premium on creating ceremony as markers for important stages, including joining, the tribe.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about that.
She's brilliant at that.
Leaving your roles, but go ahead.
Ooh, say about that.
I do think that that's one of the genius that the Mankind Project has as a ritual initiation, a healthy initiation to healthy masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
They're not afraid to use some ritual. And many of the women's trainings that have been advised by that or have grown out of that focus have also made beautiful, beautiful use of ritual. And I was in a little club as a little girl, and we did ritual, the Buttercup Club.
Oh.
Every summer we were strong. And so we had our initiation rituals, like climbing through the half-acre raspberry patch on rabbit trails every summer. You had to do it.
Oh, wow.
So I bring a lot of ritual to it. We use some smudge sometimes or some lavender or rosemary branches to kind of smudge people. We do water rituals of bringing in the waters gathered from all over the earth on our travels and washing each other's hands.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these things go into the brain in a whole different way.
They do. I feel like we just went through the training.
Yeah.
It was like what it was is that we weren't just stuck in our heads here. We weren't just doing an exercise with a person.
Yeah.
There's something deep that happens when you pay the attention to wash someone else's hands carefully, and everyone does it differently. It's like, what I also appreciate is it feels like in the book at least, you're certainly saying, make it up as you go along.
Yep.
Create the kind of ceremony or ritual that suits you, you know?
We're building this plane as we're flying it, is our metaphor. And I want to say you alluded to one of the ceremonies, one of the rituals that we let everybody know as we invited them into the tribe and went through the training and got everybody up to speed on the structure and the values and everything, the conflict resolution, that at a certain point, not too far in the distant future, we were going to ask to be de-rolled. We, as founders, as champions, we invited the tribe at some point when it didn't take long, it was probably less than a year, and we said, we've kind of given you everything we've got, and now we'd like to be de-rolled so we can be just part of the tribe, just a regular member. So they created a beautiful ceremony and ritual and formally de-rolled us, and we're just regular Joes now.
Yeah, we're co-creators, and that's what's so beautiful is that even though we took the spot of head man, head woman in the beginning, we all are now co-creators.
I think that is sheer brilliance.
And I got to tell you, it took me about a year after we de-rolled to really feel the tribe around me and to know that it was my tribe and I wasn't some leader. I was just one of the tribe. And I had this sense, of, almost like a dream, of just being able to just fall back into the arms of my tribe, And I mean,
nice.
I just feel that viscerally, like I was home. Yeah.
Wow. Because I can well imagine that certainly with many intentional communities, the problem is you do need a leader. You do need somebody to initiate that energy.
Mm-hmm.
And then that person staying in that role gets a lot of projections, get more demands than they really can humanly handle, and we are then not learning, we're not outside of of domination culture, no. You know, hierarchical yep. culture.
And it's not going to endure either. It's not
yes,
going to,
that's right.
It's not going to have a progeny, you know, it's not going to go on. If there's one person that will not let go of the reins, that's what I think is so brilliant about the
yeah,
Mankind
yeah.
Project, a circumstance came up where in order to navigate that, they let go, the founders let go of being
yeah.
in control of it.
Yeah,
and
as soon as we
grown.
Let go, men all over the country just grabbed on and took responsibility and built something
yeah.
so beautiful and so.
I'm hearing that is there a natural, and maybe we are relearning that tribal, you know, wiring in a way that
yeah.
there are natural roles at different stages in the evolution of groups. What you're attempting here by de-rolling yourselves is a kind of heterarchy, a kind of equality and in empowerment of each person
uh-huh.
is what I. What I'm gathering.
Yeah,
now, I got to ask, how do if the group changing relationships inside of, you know, you're in the tribe, a couple wants to split apart, or you find somebody is just really toxic. Are there ways to deal with changes of relationships, or are we still working? We're still building the plane on the way out.
Well,
you know,
we
on
have
the way
had people who, because of their agreements for transparency. They did come forward and surprised us all by saying in the meeting, we have something to share with you. We are separating.
Mm.
And well, we're separating and we want your blessing. We want your support. And we want to do a ending our relationship ceremony right here, right now with you.
Wow.
I took it very seriously, sharing their status
mm.
with them. And we were very surprised. But mm. we also were there. And it was surprisingly moving for each of us. It was like, wow, what? They really are committing to us that they're going to separate, but they're mm. going to still remain in this tribe, and they're going to still be able to love each other. So we have gone through that test.
Mm.
We have gone through that.
It's big for everyone.
Mm-hmm. And we've had some people who have gone through the training. And then we have this agreement, which we haven't quite mentioned yet, that there is a 3-month to 6-month
provisional
membership
mm-hmm.
time
mm-hmm.
to see if it's a fit for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And they decided it wasn't a fit for them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And
okay.
so we had a ceremony that allowed them to go, and
good.
We blessed them,
good.
And they left.
Yep.
And we were very sad to have two of them
yeah.
leave. That and also has happened.
And you can see the care that we take in bringing in new people, so they... possibility of having somebody toxic is really low, and just in case, you know, we were to grow, and we do have a very precise way of handling that
right.
also,
mm-hmm.
built in.
Mm-hmm.
That we all
again,
know.
Came from Diana Leaf Christian. She
mm-hmm.
said, "You must have an exit strategy written in the beginning."
Good, good. So that you know, because I realized that if you were doing, say, if your governance were like full consensus, everybody has to agree, you'd have one person that could sabotage the
mm-hmm.
whole works always.
Oh,
so
yeah.
We
yeah.
did. Go ahead.
I'm going to jump because we've only got
sure.
about
okay.
7, 8, 9 minutes. I want to go to the training that we just did.
Oh, good.
Which is, if I understand it right, you have folks who are invited to be sponsored into tribe, and in that provisional membership time, if I not mayor, they go through a training.
Yeah.
That's got basically what you covered with us.
Yeah.
Right?
That is one
talk
of the
about
pieces.
About that training, because then you have a common base.
Yeah, exactly. That's a piece that was so important that we didn't, you know, in one of our experiments earlier, we didn't have it. And I consider it one of the reasons that we success now. We basically got 15 hours of training, which you could do on a weekend, or we do it in five Tuesday nights. And it includes a lot of the intimacy training that we just shared.
Mm-hmm.
That's really important. Mm-hmm. A lot of the gender safety stuff so that men and women can really feel safe with each other. And then the conflict resolution piece so that we all know that stuff. And then we actually just go through almost in a very simplistic way, you know, here's the values one at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Here's
discussing.
The structure here so that
right.
everybody gets all of that stuff. And then they have the opportunity to opt in as a provisional membership. As a provisional member, of course, we do ceremony to bring them in,
mm-hmm.
and then they go through their 3 to 6 months before they make the final opt in, at which point they create, this is, we came up with this too, they create their own ceremony.
Oh, lovely. Your own initiation ceremony.
Of taking their vow to step in, and it's been charming to watch what people come up with.
Such a variety. What fun. Very creative.
You know, that structure, what you just talked about, those five sessions, if you will, which we just experienced here with you, I saw it partly a combination of some of what we've discussed here of the values that your group has, and I also see it as lending tools and common language for things that you will do later. So when you did, say, I mean, one of the most profound for me was the day we did gender safety.
And safety of gender fluidity, too.
And that included, we had a group, you know, we had folks that identified as male, and probably were all biologically male, and women. And we also had a group of folks who either not specific or different fluid gender or whatever. And it was like really, really both affirming for people to be who they are. And that's really relevant in these times. The other thing is that you raised the question, I think it was from Alison Armstrong's work perhaps, it's well known ways in which women don't feel safe with some men in this culture, but it can go the other way as well. Oh. And I really appreciated that groups raised questions. Mm-hmm. And we got into the shaming, blaming, hurting one another. I was like, that could be, I mean, that is, it's a whole workshop on itself, I felt.
And that certainly brings in Brené Brown's work on shame and vulnerability. Yeah. And that's probably why our group is so successful, is that we allow the shame to be right up front, because you need to tell your stories of shame. Because if you put it in a Petri dish and you water it, with secrecy and with silence, it will grow.
Yes.
So empathy is what contradicts or takes away shame.
And I was so appreciative of that, because we're in a shame-based culture. Mm-hmm. You aren't good enough, your body isn't, you don't look good. It's like full of, you aren't okay in this culture. So buy this product and you'll be fine, or whatever, illusions that we do. So I was really appreciative of that. And I felt, the room, the presence in the room when we were sharing those questions with one another said to me, we are going into tender places and people are being so courageous.
Yeah.
I mean, I was profoundly moved by people's courage in telling their stories.
That shame-based culture thing just gave me a sense of, like, how do you step out of this pervasive shame-based culture without being a hermit? And I think we've created a place where we can do that, where we can actually be with a bunch of other people regularly and consistently where that doesn't exist.
Where we can really be authentic with each other. Or you can catch each other on it, or you can talk about it, just pull it out of the shadows. Watch the shadow. Here we are again. Yeah. Are there other thoughts or reflections that you've had about
Well, there's so much.
There is. Actually, I will pause while you're just sort of thinking. I want people to know how they can find you.
Okay.
Where, websites, books, whatever. And you are starting to... Actually, there are other groups. That's what I want to ask.
Yeah.
I have other groups.
We have a group in Belgium that we have helped to get going. And... they're outside of Belgium, and there's another group in Talent, which is close to us. In Montana and in Hawaii.
So I do want to say that because we've done this and worked at it for so long, and we finally succeeded, we're so passionate about wanting to get it out, because it's so beautiful. We've got this chunk of gold that we just want to give away, and so I'm so glad that you two came to be with us and learn. And this is a really passionate group. There's going to be some tribes growing.
Yes, there is. I mean, I felt that on our last day. Thank you. Our last days, you gave us a chance to bless each other as we made our commitment, our intent to create tribe where we are. Boy, I just felt like the bonds in that group, there are going to be some real good sprouts coming up from this.
Mm-hmm. I think what was going on is this kind of radical experiment in learning our self, our worth, and our self-worth. Mm-hmm. And that is changing the game. When you really can appreciate and love yourself and be patient and self-mentoring, you can develop the ability to have your essence, your essential self, start mentoring all of those broken and damaged parts of our innocent one that we've abandoned. Mm-hmm. Things start changing radically. One time, a woman said, you know, I don't know what I bring to this group. I have no idea what my gift is. And so she was invited to sit in the middle and ask, may we tell you how we see you as a gift? Mm-hmm. And we went around and we just spoke in this delicious way that people don't usually speak to each other. And at the end she goes, I now see how you perceive me. Mm. It was so different.
What a blessing.
I know, what a blessing. And what courage for her to sit there and receive that too. So it's changing, we're changing our neurological wiring by this practice.
Yes.
So thank you so much for allowing us to get this word out, because we so want to be of service, and it's so hard for folks to understand what we're up to. But I think this has been long enough.
We're longing to get it out.
We're longing.
And we're also longing to speak to that chord in people that are longing to belong. Because we all are longing to belong.
Absolutely.
And Lawrence Cole, who's a wonderful singer, wrote a song called Longing to Belong. And we sing it together, and we've segued it into, it goes from longing to belong to loving to be loved. Because it's a step to accept this love.
Yes,
Do you know that? Do you remember that song?
I do. I will do my best.
Well, we're going to sing it then.
Let's go.
Longing to belong, longing to be longed for, longing to belong. Hey, 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 longing to belong, longing to be loved for, longing to belong. Hey, 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 loving to be loved, loving to be loved of, loving to be loved. Hey, 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 loving to be loved, loving to be loved, loving to be loved. Hey, 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 loving to be loved. Loving to be loved, loving to be loved. Hey, 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 loving to be loved.
You're watching Peak Moment. That is a peak moment, loving to be loved. I'm Janaea Donaldson, I'm with Zoe Alleman and Bill Kauth. I think you might enjoy Drive. Watch us next time.